Well, it's good to be here with everybody. Hope everyone's doing great. Let me start off with some prayer, and then we'll get going. Lord, thank you so much for just this group here, God. I know there's just so many faithful people who go to our church. I know a lot of them are here tonight, so I just thank you for that. And just pray you would speak your words of truth through the words. Amen. Well, I know we had a good Christmas break. A couple of highlights for us was we went to see my parents, and we found a place called Bucky's. I don't know if anyone's ever heard of Bucky's before, but they had some of the best caramel corn I've ever had before. So we were in there for probably, it was kind of our family, what we'll do since we have so many kids, we'll go about not six or seven hours. We'll go about hopefully three minimum five, and then we'll take a long break. So it was a good place to get some snacks and some good food. So that was a highlight. Me and my wife also celebrated our 10-year anniversary, and I got my second pedicure ever. I know that sounds kind of crazy, but for our 10-year anniversary, I got a pedicure, and all I can say about that is her feet look a lot better than my feet. So anyway, maybe too much information there. But anyway, I'm glad to be here tonight to share with you guys. And we're going to look at a really awesome scripture tonight. And hopefully it could challenge you guys as much as it's challenged me. But I looked up a word before I got going. And it was authority. Here's how authority is defined. The power or right to give orders, make decisions, and enforce obedience. Let me read it again. The power or right to give orders, make decisions, and enforce obedience. Authorities. I was thinking about this. Man, the thing that had authority in my life for most of my life before I was a Christian was first my parents and then basketball. As I was looking through that definition, they gave orders to me, they made decisions, and they made me obey stuff. I was at one of the biggest high schools in Houston, and instead of getting in the party scene as a non-Christian, I would play basketball Friday night, Saturday, and Sunday. It's all I cared about was basketball. And I thought, man, basketball had authority in my life. And then something changed. In September 1998, a guy sat me down, and he went through the gospel with me, and two things stick out from that. One, Jesus Christ claims authority to forgive sins, and I could also have a relationship with him. And that was a day where I said, Jesus, I want to have a relationship with you. And you know, as I think about that, Jesus became my authority. And I don't know if you guys have had the same experience I had, but right from there, I wanted other people to experience that same authority. I mean, I remember it clearly. I would read the Bible all the time, and the guy who led me to Christ, I remember he took me to the University of Arkansas, and he was going to teach me how to share my faith. I was terrified, but I said I'd go because I wanted other people to experience God's authority to forgive their sins as well. I want other people to experience what I had. So I remember it like it was yesterday. He gets in this conversation with the guy, and he shares the gospel with him. And then we get to the next guy. I don't even remember if it was a guy or a girl or what, but he gets into this conversation, and then he hands me this piece of paper that had the bridge illustration on it, and he goes, your turn. It was probably the worst gospel presentation ever. I mean, I'm sure the guy is an atheist now, but I shared the gospel with this guy, and I don't know what happened, but I did it. I remember I called my friend. I was about 12 hours from home, and I said, you got to go tell my brother that Jesus can forgive him. You know, you got to go. I don't think he ever went over there, but I wanted other people to experience what I experienced. I remember one time I went to this mall as a new Christian, and I just started sharing my faith with people, and the security guard came over, and he said, sir, we're going to have to ask you to leave. I was like, what did I do? He goes, you can't proselytize in here. I was like, okay, I'll leave. So I just walked out. But that fire I had as a new Christian, what I realized was the longer I grew in my faith, sometimes the harder it was to have that kind of attitude. I don't wake up every morning now, you know, however long ago that was, and say, man, I want everyone to experience Christ's authority. I started thinking about that. And I think the longer we're Christians, sometimes the harder it gets to have that passion. So I wanted to just kind of think through this with you guys a little bit, because I know almost everyone here, you've experienced God's forgiveness of your sins. Man, you're going to heaven. You have a relationship with Christ. But I wanted to ask a couple questions here. What kind of authority does Christ have in your life right now? Has he forgiven you? Has he forgiven you, but now it's kind of, I run the show? Or has he forgiven you, and because he's forgiven you, you want other people to experience that? So we're going to run through this passage, Matthew 9, and then we're just going to look at a few things. So jump with me in Matthew 9. Starting in verse 1, it says, Jesus stepped into a boat, crossed over, and came to his own town. Some men brought to him a paralytic lying on a mat, when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Take heart, son, your sins are forgiven." At this, some of the teachers of the law said to themselves, "This fellow is blaspheming." Just kind of a quick note on that blaspheming thing there. I think we got to really think about this for a sec. Man, back in Jewish culture, if someone claimed to be God, they took that serious. You know, in today's culture, you hear it all the time. Jesus is a good guy, or Jesus is a prophet. But Jesus wasn't claiming to be a good guy or prophet. He was saying, "I'm God." And I stole this from C.S. Lewis, but think about this for a sec. If I came here to this church and said, "I'm the Messiah, worship me," you guys would be like, "What's going on here?" You wouldn't accept that. And the same thing, Jesus wasn't claiming something where you could say, "It's okay." No, the Jews were saying, "He either is God or he's not." And they took it so serious that if you weren't God, they would pick up what? Stones, and they'd throw it at him. And that's why we see in Scripture there were a couple times where the Jews were picking up stones because they wanted to kill Jesus. They took it serious. Now, they were wrong on that, but they were right in that you don't claim something this serious if you're really not that person. So Jesus was claiming something really big, and the scribes and the teachers of the law said, "This fellow is telling a lie. He's blaspheming." Okay, verse 4. Knowing their thoughts, Jesus said, "Why do you entertain evil thoughts in your hearts? Which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven or to say get up and walk?" Now, here's what's a thought here. Jesus is kind of using the lesser to prove the greater. Now, what's greater? Think about this for a sec. Is healing a person greater or is forgiving someone's sins greater? Forgiving someone else's sins is greater, but he's going to show them by using the lesser to show he has the authority to do something greater, because only God can forgive sins. And I was thinking about this. I came across a verse I think I memorized in college, but it's Romans 4, 7 and 8. It says, "Blessed are those whose lawless deeds have been forgiven." Now think about this for a sec. This is King David, Psalm 30-something. He's quoting King David, Paul is. Now King David is a king, and he's saying it's not about riches, it's not about power, but the person who's blessed is he whose lawless deeds has been forgiven. And see, Jesus knew that, but what he was doing was he was taking something still serious, but showing through healing a guy that he was God, that he had the power to forgive someone of their sins. Let's jump to verse 6. We just looked at verse 6. Let's jump to verse 7. "And the man got up and went home. When the crowd saw this, they were filled with awe, and they praised God who had given such authority to man." Now, we're going to talk tonight about the authority to forgive sins. Now, all throughout the book of Matthew, we see Jesus has a lot of authority. As a matter of fact, if you look at Matthew 7:29, Jesus taught as one who had authority. Then we jump to Matthew 10. Do you guys remember he had authority to drive out the demons? Then we get to Matthew 21:23, and they asked, "Who has given you this authority?" He has authority over the sea, over the lakes. Man, Jesus had authority. And these people didn't want to accept it, especially the Jewish leaders, but he was proving that he was the king that was prophesied in the Old Testament. And then we get to the end of Matthew, and right before the Great Commission, Jesus says, "All authority on heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples," because he has given us authority. So, one secret I learned when I was in college was when you read through the scriptures, you could actually put yourself in the scripture. You know, the times when Peter confessed Christ, you could be, maybe there was a time when you accepted Christ, and you could be like, "Man, I can relate to when I accepted Jesus Christ in my life, and I said, 'You are Lord.'" Maybe there's times when you've been scared of walking by faith, and you know, Peter, God rebukes people sometimes. You can relate to those people. I think about James and John, you know, they're like, "Can we sit by your right hand or by your left hand?" And Jesus is like, "No, that's only for the Father to give that authority." But we could kind of read through scripture, and we kind of put ourselves in those shoes. So tonight, when we look at this authority to forgive sins, what I want us to do is ask which character you most relate to right now. Because we're going to see if God's forgiven your sins, man, we know where you're going and we know what you have. But what character do you relate to most now? We're going to just look at three characters. And the first one, and as we looked at these characters, don't just look at the outward thing. I want us to look at the hearts of each of these characters. Travis talked about it a couple weeks, just looking at the heart. I know Matt talked about tonight, just looking at the heart. But don't just ask what's the outward thing. Ask where your heart is in all this situation. So the first character we're going to look at is the paralyzed man. And we're going to call him the healed heart. So let's look at verse number 2 again. Some men brought to him a paralytic lying on a mat. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Take heart, son, your sins are forgiven." Here's what's really cool about this verse. Think about this. You're a paralyzed man your whole life. You can't walk. You've probably been made fun of. You probably don't have any of the luxuries that anyone else has. And all of a sudden, we don't see this in this account, but in the book of Luke, you guys remember, he didn't just bring him to Jesus. They took the roof off the house and lowered him down. And all of a sudden, you're sitting by this rabbi, and he's not just saying, "Welcome." He's calling you his son. Isn't that awesome? Man, we accept Jesus Christ. He doesn't just say, "Hey, servant." He says, "No, you're my son here." So this guy gets lowered in the roof. The friends bring him. And Jesus, he doesn't say, "Hey, if you act good, I'll forgive you." He doesn't say, "I might forgive you in the future." No, he says, "Son." Picture what an honor that would be to sit at Jesus' feet, being a paralyzed man your whole life, and he calls you son. It's awesome. And he calls him son, and he says, "Your sins are forgiven." Now, I remember back in 1998, what I was telling you guys, man, when Jesus forgives our sins, he forgives them past, present, and future. When he forgives us our sins, when he looks at me, even when I struggle daily, he doesn't see Nate struggling. Because of what Christ did on the cross, he sees Jesus' blood, just like the Passover in the Old Testament. And that's awesome to see just how he looks at this guy. And then in verse 5, he says, "Which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven or to say, 'Get up and walk'? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," then he said to the paralytic, "Get up, take your mat, and go home." Man, he healed him. He changed his life. Now, we see the physical change here, but there was also a spiritual change. And that's the bigger change. Man, when God forgives us, man, he changes our eternal destiny. I remember talking to a missionary doctor, and he's been all over the world, and he said, "Man, as much as I love helping people, man, it doesn't matter if I heal them, they're going to die. Their spiritual destiny is the bigger picture here." I guarantee you Bert Strom would say the same thing with all the things he does. But what I want to look at real quick is this paralyzed guy. This represents everyone at some point. Everyone's a paralyzed person. This paralyzed guy, he couldn't get to Jesus if he tried. Someone had to take him. And here's the thing. People, when I go out with youth these days, or when I look at America, man, there's a lot of spiritually paralyzed people. You see it all over the place. You see, man, today, abortion is considered a good thing in a lot of places. You see the drugs. You see, and I know it's not just this generation. I know my generation struggled as well, but I remember riding in a bus a couple weeks ago, it was last year, and there were some girls, and this girl was 11 years old, and she was talking about how she was waiting to have sex till she was 11. And I'm sitting there, I'm like, 11? That's waiting these days? So my point in saying all this is we live in a spiritually paralyzed place. I could give you all kinds of stats, but I don't need to. The bottom line is there's a big need, and it's not because of this generation. It's because of original sin. Here's the thing. A lot of people in church, we could look better than people outside the church, but we still have a sin problem. And all of us could look good compared to someone. I could look good compared to Hitler. You could look good compared to the person next to you maybe. But ultimately, we all have a sin problem. And that could only be taken care of through Jesus Christ. And when he said, "Your sins are forgiven," he said, "I completed it. It is finished on the cross." 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation." This paralyzed man was a new creation. Ephesians 1:3 says, "We have every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms." Think about that. If you're in Christ, it doesn't say you have partial blessings. It says you have every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms. And this paralyzed man went from having this evil heart, or sinful heart might be a better way, to having a healed heart because Christ had forgiven him. And I think about when he gets up and walks, this is one of the best thoughts I could think about. I think about, just kind of go with this picture with me for a second. But picture someone drowning, and then someone comes by and they rescue them. Picture, you know, you're drowning in sin, and Christ comes up and he rescues you, and then he brings you back to this awesome shore. And I think this paralyzed guy was like, man, it'd probably be nice to stay here. It's not cold on the shore. I'm not struggling to get up. But you know what? I bet he was ready to go back in the water so he could rescue some of his friends because he knew where he'd come from. So that kind of leads us into the second person. The first person was a paralyzed guy. The second guy was the pal, the buddy, whatever you want to call him. And we're going to call him a pure heart, not because his heart's pure, but because it was pure because of what Christ did. Now let's look at this verse again, okay? Verse 2, some men brought to him a paralyzed man lying on a mat. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, take heart, son, your sins are forgiven. I wrote something down here, but it says, we must realize that our faith or lack of faith has an impact upon the lives of others. Think about that for a sec. We must realize that our faith or lack of faith has an impact upon the lives of others. Now, here's what I want you to see in this verse. Matt today talked about faith. He talked about, man, there's past faith, there's present faith, and then there's future faith, justification, sanctification, and glorification. But let's look at this verse 2 again. It says, Jesus, and they brought to him a paralytic lying on a bed, seeing their faith. Now, this is just really interesting to me because it doesn't say they saw the paralyzed man's faith. It said they saw whose faith? Their faith. And I was studying this. I was like, man, this is really interesting. And the only thing I could think about was the woman at the well. Because if you remember, the Samaritans and the Jewish people, they didn't like each other. It was like racism. They hated each other. And as a matter of fact, if a Jew could go a longer distance or go through Samaria, he would go the longer distance. And if you remember the story, Jesus, of course, doesn't go the long distance. He goes straight through Samaria, and he confronts this woman. He's like, hey, you got 5 husbands. And it was a time when, you know, if you got divorced once, it was looked down upon then. So this is like, in today's time, this girl had like 500 husbands. You know, she'd had a lot of husbands, and Jesus is confronting her sin, but ultimately he says, you're missing out on the living water. I'm the living water. And if you remember the story, she goes back to her village and she becomes a missionary. Because of what Christ did in her life, she was like, you know what? I'm going to go tell my people. But turn to John real quick, because this verse just came to me as I was thinking about this story. John 4:39, if you want to turn there. And it says, many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, it is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world. One of the best definitions I've heard of sharing our faith is it's one beggar showing another beggar where the food's at. Think about that for a sec. It's one beggar showing another beggar where the food's at. And this verse right here, the woman went back and she was like, you got to believe. I found the guy. He knew everything about me. You got to believe in him. And they were like, we'll believe. And then Jesus shows up a couple days later and they're like, hey, we believe first because you told us, but now we've experienced Christ. And this thought just came to me as I was preparing this talk, so I don't know all the details on this, but maybe that's part of what we do. We just bring him to Christ, and maybe at first it's like they jump onto our faith a little bit, but once they taste Christ, maybe that's their testimony. Man, Gary brought me to Christ. Man, I believe because he told me about him, but man, I've experienced him now. Man, I believe. I've experienced this Jesus. We go around this whole room. Man, we brought him to Christ, and maybe it was almost through our faith they believed, and then they experienced Christ, and oh, he died for me. He loves me. Taste and see that the Lord is good, right? That's a scripture in the Psalms. And I was thinking about this verse. Man, this pal, now, something about me, I love evangelism. It doesn't matter if it's cold turkey. I remember there was one time I was in Boulder, Colorado, and I was like the pallbearer, and this guy was doing street preaching. I mean, I'll try any kind of evangelism. I love it. But this evangelism that's talked about in this scripture, it seems like these friends had legitimate relationships with lost people. It seems like they had friends who were lost that it wasn't just like, hey, I'm going to share my faith with you and then leave you there. They really had a relationship with these lost people, it seems like. So as I was thinking about that, I thought about, man, how many lost friends do I have that are not just, hey, I know you once and see you, but how many lost friends do I have? Let me share this with you. It's something I looked up kind of preparing for this talk. Here's common misperceptions of the church from lost people, okay? The church is an organized religion with a political agenda. The church is judgmental and critical. The church is dominated by males and oppresses females. The church is homophobic. So those were some misconceptions. And here's the deal. Lost people are never going to get us all the way. I mean, we got to be honest about that. But wouldn't it be awesome if these weren't the misconceptions about us? What if it was like, man, they love people too much. They're a little weird, but they really love people. And as I looked at this study, what I started thinking about is one of the things we struggle with as Christians, like I said, for me even, man, at first when I became a Christian, all my friends were lost people. And it's like the longer we're Christians, our friends become Christians. And it's not all bad, but it's hard for us to relate to these lost people. And I think we just got to be really careful of being intentional and making sure we have lost people that we're connected to. Going back to that rock example, man, the longer we stay on that rock, the harder it is to get off the rock. The more comfortable we get. And I heard the illustration like this. It's like once we get on the shore, all these clubs start. And they're good clubs. Maybe one's a Sunday school club. Maybe one's a deacon's club. Maybe one's a, I mean, we could go on and on. Maybe one's a Friday night. These are good clubs, and God intends us to be close with other Christians. But I think sometimes we get in all these clubs to the point where we can't even relate to people outside the church walls. And instead of going back out and doing it because Christ did it for us, we'd rather stay and be safe. One of my favorite quotes is by two guys, John Wesley. He said, the world is my parish. Think about that. The world is my parish. And then Spurgeon said this, some people want to live within the sound of a mission bell, but I want to run a mission a yard from the gates of hell. Think about that for a sec. Some people want to live within the sound of mission bells, but I want to run a mission a yard from the gates of hell. Think about this question for a sec. What is your motivation? Again, Matt hit on some of this morning, but do we do this so God loves us more? No. We should want to bring people to the feet of Christ because he already does love us. We're not doing it to gain his favor. We're doing it because we already have his favor. Here's a second question to think about. If you're the friend, the pal, how many lost people are you friends with? Like that would actually call you when something goes wrong in their life. Do you have a couple people that you're real friends with, even if they never accept the gospel, man, that you're going to be their friend and be for them? And when they go through that divorce, when they go through someone dying, man, you're the person they call because they know there's something different about you. So that's the second person, the pal. So we've looked at two people so far. We've looked at the paralyzed person who had the healed heart because God forgave him. And then we saw the pal, the friend who had the pure heart. And lastly, we're going to see the Pharisee. And the Pharisee, as the scripture says in verse 3, has an evil heart here. Now let's read this verse real quick. It says, at this, some of the teachers of the law said to themselves, this fellow is blaspheming. Knowing their thoughts, Jesus said, why do you entertain evil thoughts in your hearts? Now we could go back and forth. Jesus knows everything. We also know that when he came to earth, he gave up a lot of his divine power. So I don't know if he just like looked at him and said, he's evil. But maybe he just knew because of the questions he was getting from that, man, they had an evil intention in asking themselves this. Now let's be real clear here. These Pharisees in this specific chapter were not Christians, okay? They said Jesus was lying. So they're definitely saying, no go, Jesus, okay? So you got the knowing Pharisee. But here's what I want to challenge us with is there's a book, and I think it mattered, Travis showed it to me. It was called Accidental Pharisee. Now, here's the thought process. Sometimes, because of what I said earlier, we get in these little groups and cliques. I think we could become accidental Pharisees. We don't try to. I don't think it's our intention, but we kind of get in a little clique or a group. And I was thinking about this when I was working with college students. Here's how I was a Pharisee. I'll just be real honest with you. The ministry I grew up in, it had some great discipleship stuff. But one of the things they did was you had to record how many times you shared the gospel each week, okay? So I remember there was a couple weeks where I hadn't hit my quota. So I would be like, man, I got to share at least two or three more times. I know it's great motives, right? You know, just to hit a quota, not to love God or love people, but just to, you know, write down something on a quota. But here's what I would do. Sometimes I would look at other Christians and I'd say, man, if you're not sharing the gospel like I'm sharing the gospel, yeah, you're a Christian, but I'm better than you. And I think we do this all the time. You know, I think what happens is we take something good, a conviction, and then we try to place it on somebody else. That's kind of what I think a Pharisee does. It's when you take something that's not necessarily bad, but you make it a law or a rule. And I think that's how we can kind of become accidental Pharisees, if that makes sense. And I came up with a couple reasons of why I think it's easy for believers to lean towards this heart of a Pharisee. One is we expect the preacher to do all the work instead of every member being a minister. You know, Matthew 4:19 says, come follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. And Jesus says, come follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. Now, I know our church has so many gifted people, and I just think about like the different jobs people have. I guarantee you someone who's working in a job can reach the people at their job a lot better than me, Travis, Matt, Tommy, Ken, anybody, okay? So number one, God set up pastors to equip the body for the work of the ministry. So I think that's one of the first things that makes us have this heart. So it's just easy to say, man, he's gonna do it, so I don't have to. Something else I put on here was, I think we just get in our Christian cliques. And I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing that we have our Christian groups. That's good. God calls us to that. Different talk for a different day. But it's like we get so close to other Christians that we forget that, man, Jesus left the 100 to come after us. We forget in Luke 19 that Jesus said, I've come to seek and to save that which was lost. We forget where we have come from. A great story is one of my friends back in a different state works with a church. And his church is an awesome church. They're doing great things. And he told me that they have their church kids and their non-church kids. And they have this outdoor basketball goal. And at this goal, these kids would come and they would shoot. And some of the church members didn't want those kids there. It wasn't even in the church building. This was outside of the church building. And one of the church members who didn't want the non-church kids there, he actually took the goal down. And he took it to wherever his office or whatever his house. But what he did in the process was he broke a bunch of glass bottles and he made it look like the non-church kids broke the goal. And then one day, one of the deacons was at this guy's house and he was like, that kind of looks like our old church basketball goal there. And he's like, well, that's because it is a church basketball goal. I mean, he got called out for it. Long story short, he had to put the goal up. And this is an awesome church, so it's nothing against this church. But the point is, I think our hearts can lean towards having that kind of heart towards other people if we're not careful. One of the things that helps me is just walking with the Lord, because the longer I walk with Christ, I don't know if this has been your experience, but the more sinful I realize that I am. It's like the closer I get to God, the more sinful I realize that I am. What gets me excited about our church, and especially this group here, is I could look in this audience, and man, I know that our heart is not to be a heart of Pharisees. I know Gary Pearl, getting to know him was just a huge blessing, just seeing, man, how God has just given him a love for the Lord, and man, this guy would just do about anything. I could go down this whole room. I've been in the Belenes. I've been on mission trips with Mark White, with Daryl and Dee. I remember one of my highlights was staying with Les and Dora, and just, I remember in the mornings, they would just be in their Bibles. I'd be like, man, I hope that I'm, if I live that old, that I'll be in my Bible. Not that sounds bad. I mean, I got five kids, you know, I'm close to a heart attack. That wasn't bad, but I was just sitting there and I was saying, man, Les has driven that bus for like longer than I've been alive because he gets it. He wants to, he doesn't want to be that Pharisee. And I started thinking about that. And I didn't even know Mr. Hawkins, right? Just passed away. But they were talking about him and they said God wouldn't take him home because he was sharing his faith so much. I was like, holy cow, this is like, I don't even deserve to go to this guy's funeral. And I was like, we just got some great people. And I could go down the list with probably everyone in here. And that's awesome. But I think we need to, as a church, realize that just because we got awesome people here, we got to be praying over and over that we don't lose this heart and that we daily desire to be the pal. As I was thinking through this, one of the things I do, like I said, spend time with God and preaching the gospel to yourself every day. I think that's a great place. I was thinking about the disciples. Do you guys remember there's one disciple who didn't leave Jesus at the cross? It was John. Now, we went from 12 to 11 because obviously we had Judas in there. But think about this. 10 out of 11 of those disciples, they fled, right? They got out of there. Now, they doubted, okay? They had a weak moment of faith. You could call whatever you want, but they didn't do so hot at that time. Now, these guys are pretty sharp guys. If you look into the disciples, they're pretty sharp guys, okay? Now, what's interesting is, they saw the resurrection, they saw Jesus, and then all 10 of those guys who left Jesus ended up, what? Getting killed for their faith. Think about that for a second. John had it easy. He got sent off to the island, you know, and he wrote this crazy book called Revelation. But the rest of them, we're talking about speared, crucified, chopped their heads off, you name it. Think about that for a sec. Man, they knew that what Jesus did on the cross was real. They saw the resurrection, and they also knew how much Jesus loved them. And I think for us, if you've walked with Christ long enough, you know you're not worthy. And that's why it's one beggar showing another beggar where food's at. So I'm gonna leave you with this question, then we got a video to kind of close out the service tonight. Do you have a place, a target, where you're trying to reach lost people? Where in your life, here's the thing, you don't have to get like crazy about it. You know, some people, I know a guy who said, man, I'm gonna work out at the gym at 4 o'clock every day so I can meet lost people. I know some of you guys, it could be your work. There's people at your work and you say, this is my target. Maybe for you, it's your neighborhood. You can say, man, because what Christ did for me, I'm just a beggar who wants to show my neighbors who Christ is. I don't know, be creative. There doesn't have to be any fancy way. Maybe there's a family member. Maybe you like to get your pedicure. Yeah, that's what it's called, pedicure done. You know, some people like their pedicure. Maybe that could be your target. Be creative. But is there a place in your life where you could be the pal who's bringing other people to Christ? Where you could actually build some friendships with people outside the church walls? So I want you to think about that. And then I want you to think about, because of what Christ has done for me, what's one thing I could do this week? And guys, I'll be honest, I need to do a better job at building some real friendships with lost people this week. I've been really challenged by this scripture. But think of one thing. It doesn't have to be ginormous, but what's one thing you could do? Could be, I'm going to start praying for that neighbor who's crazy. I don't know, but think through, what's one thing you could do this week to really be a friend who brings other people to Jesus? Let's watch.